1977. The tragic news spread that Elvis had died in his beloved home, Graceland.
Precious love.
Mr. Vernon, Elvis's dad, called J.D. and wanted him to come over there to Memphis and kind of help him with this thing, help him with the funeral. He trusted old J.D., you know, and they just kind of like a, J.D. was a family member, so to speak. So J.D. and myself went over there and we sat right there in the den in the jungle room and made out the funeral, the whole program.
I received a call from Memphis, J.D. Sumner, and also Mr. Presley, Elvis's father. And he told me that he had passed away, and I said, well, I knew that. I heard it on the radio. He said, well, what we're calling about is Mr. Presley wants you to come and preach at the funeral. And also, he wants you to tell what happened when you and your wife, Maud Amy, met with him in Las Vegas.
At the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand.
I remember pulling into Graceland, as we pulled into the gates, and I saw those 20,000 people. My first thought was, this guy's like the President of the United States. I mean, this is big. And it just went all over me how big his death was. And so we drive up to the house, and of course everyone that is anyone was there. In fact, I saw Caroline Kennedy sitting on the steps leading up to his bedroom. She was a little girl. And Elvis is the kitchen. They were cooking food. It was like an old Southern wake, you know.
You come in the front door and to the right is the living room, and to the left, it's like most of these antebellum houses, to the left is the dining room, you know. So there's not a lot of room in there, but there's a couple hundred people, you know, just crammed into these first couple rooms. And so when it came time, Rex Humbard did the eulogy, and the quartets, of course, would come and sing around the piano, and everybody else then. There were some chairs in the living room where the immediate family sat, of course. And then the hallway, or the vestibule that between the living room and the dining room, starting there and all the way into the dining room, there were just people crammed in there, you know, trying to look into the living room to see what was going on.
The ones that were there were friends, our staff, our close people. The public was not invited at all to that funeral. The quartets were there that he had sang with, and they'd sang with him. His manager, of course, Colonel Parker. Some of the Hollywood people that he had known was present there also. But the main thing was the spirit and the feeling that was generated when all this gospel music was sang by these various quartets as a group, not as individual quartet, but as all of them came together, their voices was tremendous. There was something that created an atmosphere that was very, very spiritual, which made it easy when I got ready to talk.
When Joe Garcia, who was Elvis orchestra director, learned that I was going to sing How Great Thou Art, he came to me, he said, Mr. Blackwood, said, I have directed Elvis singing How Great Thou Art hundreds of times. Would you give me the honor of letting me direct it one last time? I said, why, sure. And when I did How Great Thou Art, Mr. Garcia stood over the side, directed me with tears running down his face. That's a scene that is indelible in my memory. I would never forget that moment. What a touching, touching thing it was.
We'll understand it.
wasn't like a particular group, like the Blackwood Brothers didn't sing, or the Statesmen, or the Imperials, or the Jordanaires, but it was a member or two from different groups put together to make a group and to sing some songs that Elvis would have wanted to hear. And I had to, you know, and I played for one of the numbers, and it was a makeup group with a, you know, with different members, Jake, and of course they did several songs.
Vernon wanted me to sing Known Only to Him. That was one of his favorite gospel songs.
And after that, we had the funeral procession. Down the street, thousands and thousands of people, families, aged, young people, older people. But one thing impressed me that I'll never forget. We came up to a cross street, and at that cross street there was a guy on a motorcycle, the sleeves is all cut out, red, big tattoos on his arms. And as we came down the street toward him, he reached up and got this great big helmet sitting on that big motorcycle. He put it over his heart. And when we came by, he put his hand up to his head and saluted. I thought, what love.
Father.
Fans gathered at the front gate for a massive candlelight vigil. As a kindness to those assembled, the casket was placed in the foyer of the mansion, and mourners were allowed to file by and pay their respects. On August 18th, the normally short drive to Forest Hill Cemetery took over an hour due to the throngs gathered to mark his passing. The occasion had all the trappings of a state funeral.
We understand.